our director of faith formation. Yes, that's what I looked up anyway, so correct me if I'm wrong. We'll be giving us a talk instead. Tonight it's visiting the imprisoned, correct?
Correct.
All right. So, you don't need to hear any more from me. You heard plenty from me earlier. Without further ado, John Hartnett.
Well, thank you for that warm welcome. Again, for the great food. It really was good. You know, the last time I gave a talk where they served beer, it had a funny consequence. I got drafted into doing one of those theology on tap talks at a bar in St. Paul, Sweeney's, if you've ever been there. And I had never been before giving this talk. And it was around the 4th of July. I always figure I get asked to speak 4th of July week because nobody's around anyway, you know. And so I was asked to give a theology on tap talk. And so I wondered what it would be like to give theology in a bar. And very hot, humid night, no air conditioning, and I'm up there, and I'm soaking wet by the time the evening was done. And what really surprised me was my future son-in-law came to the talk. And my daughter works for Mary Jo Copeland downtown, and he was going to pick her up about 9. He said, "Well, I just came to, you know, kind of kill the time." Well, thanks. Anyway, the talk is over, and he said, "You look like you could use a beer," and right then it really would have tasted good. I said, "Sure." So he bought me my first Blue Moon. And anytime I think of Moon, I always think of, you know, it's a sign of lunacy. After the beer was over, he asked for permission to ask for my daughter's hand in marriage. So I don't know if that gave grounds for an annulment of the agreement. So anyway, you're probably wondering why when Dr. Morgan asked me to step in tonight, he gave me a choice of, I think, 3 different corporal works of mercy. And I said, "Well, give me 24 hours and I'll get back to you." And I chose the one I least wanted to do, and that is visit the imprisoned. But there's a little story behind why I chose to do it. And tonight, there'll be a few random things we'll touch on. Visiting the imprisoned, which today, on a practical level, means much more than the classic go to a prison or a jail. Okay. Mercy, which is what we're talking about in this year of mercy, that you've been going through the corporal works of mercy. And fatherhood, obviously, being men, we have to consider what's our role in all this. And a concept of John Paul II, a little bit, I'll sprinkle in, the consolation of Christ, mercy in a fallen world. But let me start with the story and where this might be going. I've been doing RCIA for almost 20 years, where I used to be, and actually a combination of about 3 parishes, before beginning to do it here. And some time ago, in March, I was approached by a man who wanted to come into the Catholic Church. Now, if you understand RCIA, it typically runs in most parishes a cycle starting in late September, early October, about 6 months of instruction, and then at Easter time you come in and then there's a brief period of things afterward. So he comes in March. Of course, Easter is right around the corner. And I said, "Well, I was trying to discern his urgency. I'm happy to work with an individual, but obviously it needs more work." I was being selfish. It was the end of Lent, where I'm usually very tired, more tired than usual. And I picked up in this young man a real urgency. I said, "Do you want to wait till fall?" Because I do believe the group classes are, they enrich the experience, because you see a lot of different people coming from all different angles coming toward the church. But I picked up this great impatience on his part to begin. So knowing that, you know, I'm in the latter half of life and I'm going to face my maker someday, and I don't want to get there and have him say, "You know, that guy who really wanted to come in and you didn't have time for him." Well, I figure I better have time, you know, operating on a totally selfish mode. So we begin. But it was puzzling as his life began to unfold a little bit over the first few weeks. You know, he was a happy, well-adjusted, member of, I guess what I would call a semi-denominational Protestant church, kind of like, if this is a conflict of terms, kind of a small megachurch, if you will, and he seemed very happy with it. Well, that's not usually fertile ground. Usually if somebody comes to us out of a megachurch, and I've experienced that, it's usually because they sort of tapped it out. You know, it didn't have anything more to offer, and they were looking for more, but he didn't seem to be that way. So he shared with me a little bit, but it was only part of the story. He said, well, you know, the best man I know is a Catholic. The very best man I know. And he didn't tell me anything about this guy, except that the guy who I was meeting with went to St. John's, and this other guy was going to St. Thomas. And needless to say, that crosses a significant gap. A few weeks later, he said, I've got to share with you what the real story is behind this dear friend of mine. This Sunday, his wife is driving him to prison. Well, that's not the story I expected. And he told me that, again, third hand and entirely his view, but he seemed utterly sincere, that he was a colleague from another company involved in financial and real estate work, and that he had been kind of the setup guy for a corruption within the company. And because some information had been, evidence I should say, was thrown out by the judge, this didn't happen. This young man faced a tough situation. He's a young man with two or three kids, all under 10. And he was debating, do I take the lesser charge, bite the bullet, go to prison, or fight this where the evidence is not being allowed that would clear me? He chose prison so that he could spend at least the adolescent time with his children. Now, as a father, whatever the background, talk about a tough decision, you know. So it inspired me, and I felt a greater vigor in working with this young man who, following the example, wants to come into the church. So we'll see where all that goes. Let's take a look at some of the imprisoned. Some of them have inspired us all rather profoundly. Jesus Christ. Can you think of a more unjust imprisonment than him? Or an unjust death? Remember, his death was almost a twofold. If we think about worst death scenarios, this is it. Scourging, just start with that, usually didn't kill you. It did, with occasion, certainly. And it maimed you, disfigured you. And then he went on and had to be crucified. Probably the worst death ever designed by human tortures. Peter, the first pope, apostle, evangelist, he was imprisoned and eventually crucified in Rome, as legend has it, at his own request, upside down because of his unworthiness. Paul, great apostle to the Gentiles. Of course, as a persecutor of Christians, he was greatly empowered. But the moment he went on the other side of the fence, he was imprisoned many times. He was a Roman citizen, so they couldn't touch him, like they couldn't crucify him in that sense. But eventually, he was beheaded. And tonight I'll touch on a few saints. They always articulate the gospel far better than the rest of us can. But they are saints in some sense of the imprisoned in different dimensions. Pope St. John Paul II, Teresa of Lisieux, and Peter Claver. And I'll talk about each of those as we move forward. Visit the imprisoned originally had kind of two meanings. Literally, to visit those who were imprisoned, which was, by the way, a lot easier in the medieval and ancient world than it is today. Today, it's challenging. It also meant to ransom the captive, and we'll talk about all that in a minute, but let's begin by talking about fatherhood. Well, how's this role play with you and I? as either physical or spiritual fathers, which we all are. Well, there are great opportunities today, but there are also some areas that are rather limited. We have to kind of distinguish those and we'll get there. But fatherhood, and some of you who've heard me talk before, fatherhood is under attack. Now, it's nothing new. It began in chapter 3 of Genesis and hasn't stopped since. Okay? When the perfect father had doubt cast about his goodness by the father of lies, our old friend Satan. He cast that doubt, and Adam and Eve made the perfectly logical choice once they doubted the goodness of God, and they bought the farm in original sin. Transpires. Fatherhood today, is it safe to say it's been under attack in the last generation? I always say, look at TV shows and movies. Only a handful of them portray fatherhood well at all. Very few. Fatherhood is frequently kind of cast into a very secondary, irrelevant, unimportant role, almost incidental. Not what it is. Now, this is no attack on motherhood. I've been blessed to marry as wonderful a woman as imaginable, mother of my four children, grandmother of my three grandchildren. Delightful. But fatherhood is a role. The biggest role that fathers seem to play statistically is in the faith of their children. I don't know if you know this, but generally speaking, if in a family you have a mother who practices the faith and the father who, let's say, to one degree or another, doesn't, the best outcome is about 40% of the children will practice the faith overall. Now, if you reverse that, and dad practices the faith, about 80% practice it. There's something intimate into fatherhood in the transmission of faith. And having, as some were mentioning, I've taught adolescents my entire life. Sometimes I feel like an adolescent having done so. But I've taught a few thousand kids. And one of the things I've noticed is men, as teachers, are particularly beneficial in the adolescent years. Because it's always been said that men help transit children into the world. If mothers bring them into the world, you might say fathers play a bigger role in transiting them into their role in the world. And I don't have enough intelligence to understand all the connections there. I've just seen the evidence. That 80-40%, I've kind of watched it over the years, having taught 2,000-3,000 kids. It seems to ring fairly true. Excuse me. So, what's the chief fruit of original sin in you and in me? One of the great privileges of my life has been to know, not closely, Father Thomas Duvet. Some of you may know him as a retreat master and so forth, Maris priest. I'm actually quite close to his brother, who recently passed away, known their family, taught some of their kids. And in recent years, especially, I took up deer hunting about 15 years ago. I always promised when I stopped coaching to my eldest son that I would do deer hunting with him. He was about 14 at the time. I didn't really want to do it. Well, I had to be true to my word, so I went through the classes with all the other 12-year-olds. The problem was they outscored me on the final test too. It was really bad. It was embarrassing. Anyway, I fell in love with deer hunting. I do it every year, and I've enjoyed it immensely since. And Eli Dubay, the brother of Tom, found out about it. He's a parishioner where I worship, and invited me to come up to their place. And it was great, especially during Eli's time. And now I go with his sons. Anyway, I'm wandering way off the track. But through all that, I got to know Father Tom Duvet, who my suspicion is someday we'll be calling him Saint. Some of the rare privileges of having some personal talks with him. But perhaps the most wonderful was one time I had a chance to see him pray when he didn't know I was watching. And I saw a man in ecstasy. Literally, he was saying Liturgy of the Hours, and it was almost like I expected him to levitate. It was that profound. Well, Father Tom Dufay is a rather nasty man. Didn't sound like I was saying that. Read some of his books, and he cuts right to the heart. He's beaten me up, I don't know how many times. You know, I think I'm doing pretty well in some dimension. And then I read his book, and I feel like I'm laying on the ground. And one of his, I think, best descriptions of the effect of original sin as omnipresent egocentrism in all of us, we've all got it. Life is all about me. And what he really, I think, reminded us of, he said, this continually threatens each and every one of us. And especially, if you will, in our role as fathers. Hard to be a good father and be selfish. You know, one of the things we probably all discovered, those of us who are, you know, physical fathers, shall we say, is once you have children, your life is no longer your own, right? You know, it's everybody else's. Sometimes we're grudging about that, and we claim the little things. But it does pull us out of that a bit. It's a wonderful gift that way. But again, it threatens us. Any act of mercy that you and I do steps into that void, if you will, the gaps in somebody else's life. You know, whether you, this past week, were helping, which I ended up doing, helping remove trees from houses because our area got hit pretty hard, or whatever it is you're doing, you're stepping into something that's a gap in another person's life. The corporal works of mercy are a wonderful example of that. And it's a great form of human solidarity. Now, what are the challenges to doing this in modern times? Just as a show of hands, how many of you have actually visited a prison, you know, inside, or a jail? Okay, just a few hands. It's not an easy thing to do. You know, our prisons are sort of closed off and walled off, and they're sort of kept away from us. You know, if you really want to create a zoning crisis in your area, put up a prison, or try to put up a prison, you know. I know the hometown I grew up in, we have two. And, you know, of course, always there were a few issues, and the alarms would go off if somebody escaped and so forth. But it was always the kind of local problem. Ransoming captives, the other side of this, of course, today is considered, in some countries, it's illegal. It's often ill-advised on a practical level. And, of course, it's dangerous. So we won't spend much time there, except to say that in ancient times, where you had typically more corrupt systems, you know, the right bribe in the right place might ransom the captive. Visiting the imprisoned again today, for many of us, is not real practical, unless you get into prison ministry formally and those kinds of things. It's difficult. Somebody was asking me just before tonight, have you ever done this? I have had the privilege of working with several in RCIA work where they were able to come out. They were kind of on good behavior. And I actually found it a delightful experience. Great guys to work with. I really enjoyed it. But again, it was much more fluid in different times. Now, a few things we need to remember about imprisonment. Historically, were often innocent of any real criminal activity. Again, we don't have to go back that far to remember that a lot of people in prison were in prison for debt. They were political opponents. They were religious unacceptables. That could be us. You know, we live in interesting times. Whatever. Certainly our early Christian fathers and sisters, brothers and sisters, our early Christian ancestors were outlaws. They could be jailed simply for being a Christian. And we know that that's true in some places in our world today. Hopefully not here. Okay, but there's some threats to that, we all know. A description I read, now I can't remember where when I put this in, they described it this way. Free Christians took it upon themselves to visit their friends, bringing food, solace, encouragement, and when possible, liberation. They also sought the prisoner's blessing, since to be imprisoned for being a Christian was a mark of great courage and faith. So again, this was not going to visit somebody that we would have looked down on, but looked up to, that we would have admired. And so again, it had a very different sense when it first began. Well, let's take a look at the church today. And
let's begin by looking at recent Holy Fathers. Pope St. John the 23rd, his first act, the first time he ever left the Vatican. Now, some of you are old enough to remember when priests didn't leave the Vatican much. That's not the case anymore. That mold was utterly shattered by John Paul II, but even by Pope, a few popes before him. John the 23rd, his first visit was to a prison. Pope St. John Paul, I'm going to refer to him unofficially as the Great. I think that's a title that will eventually find its way to him. I suspect the title Doctor is not far on the horizon. Visited, if you remember, with his would-be assassin. You see it pictured down here in the lower right. You're right. Who tried to kill him in 1981, about 3 years into his pontificate. Let's talk about this guy who tried to kill him. He was 23 years old. He was sought for armed robbery in Turkey. He was a very angry young man, very troubled. He was kind of a lethal man. He was said to be a deadly shot with a pistol. In fact, he was really frustrated immediately after the assassination attempt because he had failed to kill him. He couldn't believe it. Now, we all know the Fatima thing and so forth relative to John Paul II, and we know that it was within millimeters of killing him. In 1983, after his recovery and things had been arranged, John Paul II went and visited him. They had a fairly lengthy private conversation and emerged on a rather friendly basis. Now, over the years of his incarceration, John Paul II kept in contact with his family. And in 2000, John Paul II requested the Italian government that he be pardoned, which they did. He was released, and then he was deported to Turkey, where he had to do the sentence for the armed robbery, which was initially going to be life. As you know, in Muslim countries, the sentences are steep, typically. But he was let out in 2010. During his incarceration, he became a Christian. In December of 2014, he returned to Rome and laid 24 roses on the tomb of John Paul II. And he said this, "A thousand thanks, Holiness. This is a miracle that goes on. The mystery of Fatima goes on. Long live Jesus Christ." Now, what does this wonderful example teach us? I think it's safe to say this young man was an enemy of John Paul II. John Paul II did everything he could to bring about this man's eventual arrival and sanctity. Everyone is an opportunity. Sometimes, perhaps, especially the imprisoned, they may be more keenly aware of it. Pope Francis, you may know this, celebrates Holy Thursday Mass, just like most priests. They get to wash all our feet, which I always found amusing. I still remember the first time I was asked to do it. I didn't know I was being asked to do it. I was asked to distribute the Holy Eucharist at Mass, extraordinary minister, and I didn't know I was new to the parish. I had just been asked to be an extraordinary minister. The guy who asked me to take his spot didn't tell me it was the feet washing day. He told me later he didn't want to do it. And I'm trying to decide if I'm up there, do I have holes in my socks when I'm, you know, up there, because I hadn't prepared accordingly. Felt particularly bad for the priest because my feet are somewhat aromatic. Pope Francis washed the feet of prisoners on that day. So when we think about our Holy Fathers in recent years, they're very keen on visiting the imprisoned. Well, something that is no news to any of you. You and I have only one real mission in life as fathers, to do all that we can to draw others toward union with our merciful Father. Pope John Paul and his entire pontificate did that exactly, and that's why he's one of the fastest saints in history. In the average time of canonization, I think in church history is something up towards 200 years. He did it in 6. Usually they don't even let you be considered until 5. So went very, very fast. His life, let's think about it. Think about it. Probably nothing I can tell you about this guy. Born in Poland, 1920, third of 3 children, although one of them didn't live very long. His older brother, Edmund, I think was his name, a doctor, died at age 32. John Paul's mother died when he was not quite 10. His father died in 1941 during the occupation. John Paul, too, was an orphan, basically, by the time he was into college a little bit. So what did he do? He had to live through the life of the Nazis and the Soviets. Now, of course, they are people who really respected law, had great judicial systems, you know, never put the innocent people to jail, right? Did it in spades. It was all about power. Well, in 1942, he entered a clandestine seminary run by Cardinal Sapieha. Now, let's remember, clandestine means he could have been put in jail. Only by luck, he wasn't. He also ran or developed, along with a few others, the Rhapsodic Theater. It's been portrayed in a number of the movies about it. What was that all about? Preserving Polish culture, but it was also clandestine. He was breaking the law. Okay, he was willing to break the law for important things, but could have easily been imprisoned. Eventually ordained a bishop. We know he rapidly rose through the ranks. Didn't want to. When he was first asked to be a bishop, he tried to say no. Wanted to be a parish priest, but got called to greater and greater things very quickly. Elected as Pope in 1978, and it said he visited more people than any other pope. I would suspect he visited more people than any other human being in history. You know, I think his mass at World Youth Day in the Philippines, they estimated it was 4 million. You know, Father, you're ready for that? You know, the mass of 4 million. You know, think of the logistical problems alone, you know, what a challenge. Wrote extensively. I had the curse of getting my degrees in theology during the pontificate of John Paul. And the argument we all made was we all had to keep up on his writings. He wrote faster than I could read. It just kept pouring out. And of course, how many of you remember when he died? What did everybody do who was in the crowd in St. Peter's? Remember, it was about 9 in the evening, as I recall. They clapped. It was a quiet and then gradually, not thunderous, I mean, it was not a celebratory thing, but in a way it was. We all knew a man who lived life right through to the end. Wonderful example. Let's take a look at visiting the imprisoned today. What does it mean? What's the broader thing? What's the opportunity here? And I took this from the Daily Catholic out of 2006 because I thought I gave a fine description of what it means today. If I can read. To the extent that we are imprisoned by our human weakness and imperfect nature and the resulting sin, visiting the imprisoned merely means that we extend our charity and love of others from being there for each other to helping each other free ourselves from the trap of sin. We can also be chained by confusion, deception, distortions served by this society or a lukewarm church. True social justice demands that we help others free themselves from such chains and that we not chain others to spiritual prisons even as we pretend to be freeing them of the physical prisons or having compassion for their plight. Those who really know their faith can be a tremendous help to those who are incarcerated, for you could say they have a captive audience. I think the pun was intended there. And since God often allows a man to hit rock bottom before building him back up, prisoners know best what it means and could very well be willing catechumens to learn more about the true faith and the font of divine mercy, the sacrament of penance. Do we have some confusions in our world today? Does the pace of confusion Benedict described relativism, or the dictatorship of relativism, as the great curse of our age. Right. Self-definition. Think of Justice Kennedy here. He wrote the Supreme Court decision, he wrote the majority remarks in 1992 in Casey versus Planned Parenthood. If you ever want to do some scary reading, go into that and just read that clip. And I can't quote it terribly well, I'm not good at that. But I remember reading it in 1992 and getting scared to death, where he talked about man's capacity to define his own existence and mode of existence or something like that. I'm thinking, wow. My students asked me this question one time when this first started to pop. So I decided to declare myself tall. Needless to say, I'm not. But since then, I've decided I'm tall. And I challenged them to argue with me about that. And of course, if you can define your own mode of existence, it doesn't matter. It's silly. Unfortunately, it's real. What are we sowing? Confusion, doubt, deception. By the way, what did Satan sow in Eve's mind in Genesis chapter 3? Same stuff. Same stuff. Hopelessness, culture of death, materialism, individualism, hedonism, you name it. It's all there. Unfortunately, a lot of people are trapped by all this confusion or addiction or whatever else. John Paul II was a man who was merciful to his enemy. Teresa Lisieux, I doubt I have to introduce her to any of you. Again, one of those rare birds, a doctor of the church, lived to the ripe age of 24. I think she entered Carmel at about 15, which is unusual. Lived the last nine years of her life in Carmel, in Lisieux, France. Here was an example, and if you don't mind me reading again, I realize the print may be a little small for you. She's in the convent, and she says this. This is directly from her book, The Story of a Soul, her autobiography. Just then I heard much talk of a notorious criminal, Pranzini, who was sentenced to death for several shocking murders. And as he was quite impenitent, how I longed to avert this irreparable calamity. In order to do so, I employed all the spiritual means I could think of, and knowing that my own efforts were unavailing, I offered for his pardon the infinite merits of our Savior and the treasures of the Holy Church. I said in all simplicity, "My God, I am quite sure that thou wilt pardon this unhappy Pranzini. I should still think so if he did not confess his sins or give any sign of sorrow, because I have such confidence in thy unbounded mercy. But this is my first sinner, and therefore I beg just one sign of repentance to reassure me. My prayer was granted to the letter. The day after his execution, I hastily opened the paper," LaCroix was the name of the paper, "and what did I see? Pranzini had mounted the scaffold without confessing or receiving absolution, and the executioners were already dragging him toward the fatal block, when all at once, apparently in an answer to a sudden inspiration, he turned around, seized the crucifix which the priest was offering to him, and kissed our Lord's sacred wounds three times." Power of confident prayer. St. Peter Claver, probably a familiar one to many of you, lived in the 16th and 17th centuries, was born in Catalonia, the town of Verdú in Spain, in 1580, to a very distinguished Spanish family house. But both sides of his family, while, let's say, noble and all that, were both going broke. They were impoverished, which was not uncommon at that time in Spain. He entered the Jesuit novitiate in 1602 and came under the influence of St. Alphonsus, who encouraged him to go to the Indies and save millions of perishing souls. Well, he did. He arrived in Cartagena. Cartagena was the port city, still is, northern Venezuela, where the first leg of the slave trade, almost all the ships went there. Okay. And it was where most slaves went. Remember, while we had a decent number brought to the United States, the core, the much heavier amounts, went to South America and the Caribbean. During that time, Pope Paul III, who dealt with a lot of crises, had condemned the slave trade. But the businessmen at the time were just happy to go on doing it to their financial advantage. It is estimated that about 1,000 slaves arrived at Cartagena alive every month. Now keep in mind, about one-third on average died on the voyage over. You know, if you had less than that, it was considered a good voyage. More than that, well, wasn't a good trip. He met them, cared for them, did all the, you know, literally corporal things for them. After his ordination, he dedicated himself to be a slave to the African slaves. He fed, comforted, catechized, and worked to improve treatment and to try to abolish the trade. He even himself admitted he nagged and annoyed the culture of the time there, which of course was living off slavery. He was not a healthy guy when he first went over there. And in spite of that, and in spite of this kind of almost equatorial climate, Northern South America, he worked tirelessly. They said the guy just wouldn't stop. It is said that he catechized and baptized 300,000 during his work. Amazing. Now, one of the things about visiting the imprisoned, dealing with the imprisoned, and maybe one of the tensions in our society is the tensions of guilt and innocence. We have had, historically, a good legal system in our country, and most people in prison and jail are guilty. But not all. It's not a perfect system. Again, it's got a human factor in it. And the issue of rehabilitation and protection. The church reminds us always that everyone is an image of God, no matter how well or badly you've lived your life. Adolf Hitler, image of God. Saddam Hussein, image of God. Keep naming your person. We have to also remember this is the Catholic Church. He came to save all. Okay. Even the hardened criminal has to be seen as a potential convert. And again, those at the bottom of life oftentimes are ripe for conversion. Okay. Some examples here. Well, let me finish and I'll go with the examples. Incarceration is necessary, obviously, to protect us from criminals. Some confusion in this on Catholic teaching. Even the death penalty can, in certain circumstances, be applied. Now, the church came out against the death penalty, but it's a qualified one if it's not needed. In other words, in our country, we can effectively incarcerate people where they're no longer a threat to the rest of the world. But let's imagine we were somehow living on Gilligan's Island and there was only the 12 of us and, you know, Gilligan suddenly started to be a banana. And we didn't know what to do with him and he was getting dangerous. He had killed Marianne and was, you know, now thinking about Mr. Howell. You know, we may not have the personnel to manage this. Maybe Gilligan's going to be put to death. Okay, using a crazy example. But, you know, we don't want to just suddenly pretend the prisons and so forth aren't needed. But not all are guilty. There are corrupt legal systems in the world. There is human error, judgment. And we know that incarceration has been used frequently throughout history as a political tool, as a weapon to silence opposition. We'll talk about a few of those in a minute. In fact, we know some of the most admired saints have been imprisoned and executed. A few here we might remind from our own contemporary period. On the far left, you may recognize, picture's a little small, Charles Colson. He was Richard Nixon's hatchet man, during the Watergate era, and he was guilty as heck. And he did go to prison. Got Jesus while he was in prison. And many were pretty skeptical, you know, a politician got Jesus conveniently, you know, and got out of prison. He passed away, I think, in like 2012, 2013. He did prison ministry solidly for about 30 years after he came out of prison. This was no phony conversion. A very good man, and we see him here receiving an award from President Bush. The guy here, his name is now escaping me. I read about him some years ago. Murdered three people. He's now a priest. And maybe one you've heard of, Joseph Pierce up here. Anybody know who Joseph Pierce is?
Yeah.
How many of you are familiar with him? Pierce was a terrorist. Okay. He was a Protestant Northern Irish. And he worked, I don't know if that's the right word. He served in the Protestant forces just trying to raise hell with the Catholics in Northern Ireland. And they did violence. He himself, I don't believe, ever killed anyone directly, but they did things that certainly were flirting with that. Very intelligent guy. He's a college professor now. He's brilliant in literature. While in prison, he began to read Chesterton and Tolkien and others. I had the privilege, just before he became kind of popular, to hear him speak. And he talked about it. He said, yeah, I hated the Catholic Church. I hated the Irish. Guess what he married? An Irish Catholic, you know, and is now happily ensconced in the church. Again, oftentimes our greatest enemies maybe aren't. I thought I would kind of end tonight with a few last words from some of the imprisoned greats of Catholic history. The last words. The first one up at the top is from St. Ignatius of Antioch. He was a martyr who had the interesting thing. He was a very powerful bishop, and Antioch was one of the great churches of the early times. In fact, St. Peter was once in charge of that church. So Ignatius would have been his successor. Anyway, when they were during the Roman persecutions, they kind of come in waves depending on the emperor or the local governor and how strident they wanted to be. But anyway, a pretty strong persecution came on, and they requested that this guy, this head of one of the most, maybe the most prestigious church in the world at that time, be brought to Rome to be put to death. Now, Ignatius was an interesting guy, and I remember first beginning to read about him when I studied for my degree in theology. One of the great gifts of that was we had to read at least some of the early church fathers. Now, if you've ever seen the collection in printed form, you know, it's,
you know, I think beyond my fingers.
And remember, I'm tall, so I always have a long reach. but I remember reading some of these really early guys like Ignatius and Polycarp. And if you're not on fire for the faith, read them and you will be. They're fantastic. I would encourage you. And they're all over the internet now. You don't have to go buy the 2 tons worth of books to do it. He was being transferred through the Roman Empire from Turkey to Rome. And along the way, he was allowed to visit with people. And in fact, he wrote 7 letters, one of which was to Polycarp, the next one I'm going to talk about. But let's read Ignatius. I prefer death in Christ Jesus to power over the farthest limits of the earth. He who died in place of us is the one object of my quest. He who rose for our sakes is my one desire. In fact, along the way, there were some people who were trying to rescue him from the Romans. And he said, no, don't do this. It's my time. Don't let them stop me. I'm going. Polycarp, who, like Ignatius, by the way, was a student of a guy named John, the apostle. You know, talk about, you know, getting close to the master. Short of being apostle, it's about as good as it gets. Polycarp was a beloved bishop in Smyrna. And he was 86 years old. A wave of persecution, I think it was the Emperor Trajan who was on the warpath at the time. And even the locals, the Romans, they didn't want to kill this guy. He was beloved, everybody liked him. He's 86 years old. Come on, what a name. So they offered, they said, look, just give us some token offer of incense to the gods or whatever the local custom was. And he responded this way. For 86 years I have served Jesus Christ and he has never abandoned me. How could I curse my blessed King and Savior? Did any of you, I think it was about a week ago now, if I recall, visit the relics of St. John Fisher, St. Thomas More? Okay, that would be great. I had a chance to do that too. And St. Thomas More is always, my father took me to the movie. Have, how many of you ever seen A Man for All Seasons? Okay, now for those of you who haven't, if you take away anything from tonight, see the movie. It's a rarity. It's something that came out of the movie world that's accurate, which is, you know, almost miraculous in and of itself. And it's extremely well done about a great saint. My father took me to see that movie when I was a teenager. And I've been in love with St. Thomas More, read extensively on it ever since. But first, one who died just a few days before him, St. John Fisher. He was a brilliant guy, like More. Great scholar, wonderful mind. In fact, if you saw the relics, his relic was a ring. And the ring had Aristotle on it. It was like a cameo ring. And Aristotle was on it. Great, great scholar. In fact, he was a tutor to Prince Henry, who became Henry VIII when he was a young man. Because again, he was such a great mind and teacher. During the time of Henry, if you know anything about Henry, crazier than a bed bug, changed England mostly for the worse forever. And set in motion forces that led to some really terrible things. One thing you can say about Henry, he was going to get his way eventually. You know, he always seemed to get his way. The persecutions were getting particularly sharp, and John Fisher was a bishop at that time. The Pope at that time decided, in order to try to get a better treatment, that he would make him a cardinal. He was in prison. Henry refused to allow a cardinal's hat to be brought into England, and even threatened, and sort of fulfilled on the threat, that he would send his head to Rome for that. John Fisher was beheaded. There are no relics of his body. His body was thrown in a common grave, and his head was a source of such veneration that finally, the English authorities, I believe, tossed it into the Thames to get rid of it. Wonderful, wonderful. What did he say upon his? Eternal life is this, to know you, the only true God, and him whom you have sent, Jesus Christ. I have given you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. Do you now, Father, give me glory at your side. There is enough learning in that to last me the rest of my life. When he said that, there wasn't much of his life left to go. Thomas More, I suspect, is familiar to most of you. He was a layman, father, Chancellor of England, great scholar, a true Renaissance man, the richest sense of the word. He thought he could avoid martyrdom. In fact, and it's in the movie, but it's also in the books, his wife was getting worried about him when he started to oppose Henry. And he turned to her and he said, don't worry, this is not the stuff of which martyrs are made. It's the only thing I ever knew that he didn't quite get right. He was a lawyer, and apparently he's the one you would want on your team. He knew that according to English law, if he was silent, and I can't remember the Latin phrase, my Latin's rusty, but silence implies consent. So he simply would not speak on the matter in any way to anyone, even to his family. Everybody read in what was true, but he never said. And he thought this would protect him. Well, unfortunately, he was so well respected around the world that his silence, as they say, thundered across Europe. And eventually, Henry, in one of his late rages, and there was a whole raft of martyrs during that brief period of time. In fact, Father Johnson was telling me that More sell, you know, Father Johnson's been everywhere and met everybody. And I said, I've never been to England. And he said, I said, I suppose you've seen more cell. Well, yeah. He said, it's round. And he said, it was actually quite large, about 20 by 20. He said that the hardest thing was, of course, the weather, because it really was sort of a fortress. And the windows, of which there's no glass, was a slip. Now, he's right, you know, this is England's climate, not famous, you know, for, you know, good feelings. The dampness coming off the Thames was quite tough. And, you know, he said even when they were in there, he was giving a tour, and he said the wind kicked up and began to blow, and they all started to feel the chill of the bones, you know. So anyway, I'm wandering off. He said that Moore's cell was put right near the gate where the Carthusian martyrs went out before. You know, they're trying to constantly threaten these guys, make them relay, you know, the end is near. We know that Moore, on the scaffold before he died, was even joking with the executioners about his beard being, you know, that it's innocent and that it maybe shouldn't be cut off, you know, that kind of thing. But his really key words, his final words, "I die the king's good servant, but God's first." Moore's relic was a tooth and part of the jawbone. His daughter was able to rescue his head after it was put on Traitor's Gate and gave it a proper interment. So we do have the actual relics and tons. In closing tonight, and I don't know what your formal closing procedure, but I always try to close anything I do with prayer. This isn't exactly a prayer, but it's an excerpt from St. Ignatius' letter to Polycarp. And when I first read this, maybe 20 years ago, I was stunned at how much it spoke to me today, trying to be a father in the world in which we live. And so perhaps if we could pray this slowly together, in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us not seem worthy of credit, but teach strange doctrines. Fill thee with apprehension. Stand firm as does an anvil which is beaten. It is part of a noble athlete to be wounded and yet to conquer. And especially we ought to bear all things for the sake of God, that he may also bear with us. Be ever becoming more zealous than thou what thou art. Weigh carefully the times. Look for him who is above all time, eternal and invisible, yet who became visible for our sakes, impalpable, impassible, yet who became passible on our account, and who in every kind of way suffered for our sakes. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Right? Do I...